Rolling.
Hi, I'm Dr. Kelly Morgan and Dr. Galena here, and welcome to our Keto Kickstart event. And we're really excited to talk about the ketogenic diet because it's really popular right now, and there's a lot of information about the keto diet. And so we wanted to do a talk on the ketogenic diet. How to do it properly, and we have a holistic approach to it because there's a lot of different ways that you can do a keto diet, and so we want to, we created a program, a ketogenic diet program, to support people through doing a keto diet and how to do it in a holistic way. Okay, so the ketogenic diet is basically, a lot of people are doing it for weight loss, but there's a lot of benefits to doing a ketogenic diet, and weight loss is one of the benefits from it. But we're gonna go into what a keto diet is. So it's really great for people that are struggling to lose weight, even if they're following a healthy diet and exercising. Some people can have resistant weight loss where it's really difficult, and the ketogenic diet is one way that you can help break that resistance to weight loss, in addition to all the other benefits that you can get from a keto diet, but weight loss is, you know, really one benefit that a lot of people specifically do the ketogenic diet for. So these are some of the benefits of doing a ketogenic diet. So it reduces inflammation. Of course, it improves fat burning, so that's the whole point of the ketogenesis, and we'll talk more about that. But it helps with brain fog, it improves energy, it helps clear your skin. It also reduces cravings, and then it helps with different types of chronic disease, cardiovascular disease, neurological issues, even cancer. So there's a ton of benefits from doing a ketogenic diet that go beyond just weight loss. So some of the therapeutic applications of a ketogenic diet, before it was really used for weight loss, it was actually used to help people with seizures. So that was kind of one of the main uses for doing a ketogenic diet, and then it also helps with other neurological conditions like Alzheimer's, dementia, Parkinson's disease, multiple sclerosis, and then it can help with some other like mood disorders like depression, anxiety, and with traumatic brain injuries. So it, you know, the ketogenic diet is a high fat diet, and so the nervous system, you know, is lined with lipid layers, so that one of the reasons why a lot of neurological conditions benefit from doing a keto diet. So now we're going to go into kind of the basics of what a keto diet is. So it's also known for being a low-carb diet, and it's really about the ratio of protein, fat, and carbs, with fat being about 70% of the diet. And then a moderate amount of protein, and then very low carbs. And so with a ketogenic diet, fat becomes the main fuel source for the body. Our bodies use glucose as a main energy source. But glucose doesn't really get stored in the body for very long, only like 2 days. And so people doing like with fasting, or let's say like starvation, our bodies are able to adapt to those conditions by burning stored fat for fuel. And so we're basically doing a ketogenic diet is kind of inducing sort of that state to help your body switch from burning glucose primarily, which comes from carbs, to burning primarily fat. And so the basics here, so if we lower our carb intake, we kind of force our body to use other fuel sources, which is fat and protein. And so like I mentioned before, glucose really only gets stored for 2 days, but our body can obviously store fat and has a lot more fat storage. So if you limit the amount of carbs you're eating, your body is kind of forced to start burning fat for fuel. And it is a natural process. It's a natural process to help our bodies survive in when their food intake is low. And so what happens is when you limit your carb intake and your body is forced to burn fat, your liver produces ketones, which becomes the main energy energy source, and that comes from fat burning. And so, that's kind of the basics of doing ketosis, or doing a ketogenic diet, basically putting your body into ketosis. And so what we have done is created a program where we're kind of providing like a holistic approach to the whole ketogenic diet, because there are a lot of different ways that you can do it. And so we're going to kind of guide you through that. Okay, so this is kind of just to give you a visual of the keto diet and the difference from being a sugar burner, which, you know, that's using glucose or carbs as a main fuel source, to being a fat burner, which is comes from a high fat, low carb diet, which is basically the keto diet. Let's see. I think I already talked about that, glucose being used as a main energy source. And so because fats aren't needed when you're eating like a carbohydrate rich diet, then you're not burning fat. So the whole point is to kind of get you into that fat burning mode, which really helps boost weight loss. Okay. Yeah, so when people think of like being a high fat diet, you know, you might like visualize drinking, you know, a gallon of oil, or eating some of these unhealthy high fat foods. So that's why, I mean, there's like, you know, a healthy way and an unhealthy way of doing a ketogenic diet. And so we kind of, I mean,
what is that
the program that we created, we want to really educate everyone on how to do a ketogenic diet in a healthy way. And so this is like a sample menu, just to give you an idea of like what a healthy ketogenic diet looks like. So breakfast, for instance, you could do, if you've all have heard of like the bulletproof coffee, it's like the grass-fed butter with MCT oil, which is medium chain triglyceride oil, and you blend that with coffee. And then, so you're getting a ratio of like really healthy fat, and then again, a moderate amount of protein and low carb. And so another breakfast might be eggs with avocado, olive oil. So you're getting healthy fats. And then lunch, so you're doing, I don't know if you can see that, but
yeah.
You know, you can still have like vegetables, doing like a low glycemic type vegetables or non-starchy vegetables, a small amount of protein, and then again, a good amount of healthy fats. And then you can see what a dinner, you know, a typical dinner would look like. So so it is a little bit different than like a paleo diet, because paleo is low carb also. But paleo, you're going to emphasize more protein, a smaller amount of fat, and smaller amount of carbs. Whereas a keto, it's 70% fat.
There's a chart actually later on that I will cover that compares
them. Yeah, you'll see them like side by side what the difference is. But it's just the ratio of fat, protein, and carbs that is the difference. Okay, so now Dr. Glenn is going to take over.
All right. So Dr. Morgan pretty much gave a pretty thorough introduction, actually. So this kind of goes over it again, so we'll just come quickly go through. But, you know, it talks about how carbs are stored basically as sugar, right? And then our bodies tend to use that as fuel. So the goal is to switch from burning sugar to burning fat for fuel, which Dr. Morgan already covered. So the problem, I can't really see the slide.
I know,
yeah.
It's hard to see.
The images. Basically talks about the problem of using carbs as fuel. You know, it's not sustainable. Eventually you're gonna run out of it. And then if your body hasn't learned how to use the fat to, the fat for energy, it's a problem. You're kind of stuck in this in between, right? Then also, you know, it messes with blood sugar in general, right? When you have too many carbs, it kind of throws things off in that sense. And also, excess carbs are stored as triglycerides and dumped into your blood. And, you know, we've heard all about triglycerides, cholesterol, all that. So that's not great for anyone. So that's the big problem with using carbs for energy versus any other sources. And then just talks a little bit about low carb versus ketosis. So low carb is just like randomly eating low carb, right? With ketosis, it's a very targeted approach to basically, it's not just low carb, but also using fat, you know, to kind of convert yourself into this state.
Looking at my whole menu for the last couple of days. Right there.
Okay, so again, a little bit more just as a diagram. So basically, what is nutritional ketosis, right? So which is achieving ketosis through your foods, right? So first of all, you're decreasing your carb intake. And then after you decrease your carb intake, your body is going to slowly start to learn how to use fat for fuel, fat for energy, instead of the carbs for energy. And eventually, you're going to start producing something called ketones. And we'll talk a little bit later about how we're going to actually measure those ketones. There's multiple ways to do that. And then basically, eventually starts using those ketones as the primary fuel. And you know, we still need some glucose for certain processes in our body. So this diet does allow for that, you know, but because you are taking limited carbohydrates, you're still getting some of that glycogen for your other body functions, but not for energy. And then just some benefits of nutritional ketosis. Again, so obviously weight loss, reducing
appetite.
Well, effortless in the sense where you're not starving yourself. It's not like a calorie-restrictive diet, right?
Yeah.
You're not. You don't have to go at it 4 hours at the gym, you know. So we'll talk a little bit more about that as well. So there's reduction in appetite, improvement in blood pressure, improvement in mood, lowering of your triglycerides, decreasing inflammation. Sleep is better. Brain fog, you know, helps with brain fog. Helps with the kind of digestive issues like gas and bloating. Helps with blood sugar and cravings. Oh, and you can eat more without gaining weight, right? So you can actually, you saw the sample menu, you're not starving, right? And a lot more, but those are just some of the, you know, really good benefits of ketosis. Okay, so this is, most people have heard of, you know, the ketogenic diet macronutrients, right? So macronutrients are the carbs, the protein, and the fat. So this is kind of like a general breakdown, right? So carbs should be about 5 to 10% of your daily intake. Protein should be about 20 25%, and fat should be about 70 to 80. It's gonna vary from person to person, and when you go online and you can just Google a keto calculator, there's all kinds of calculators out there that will, you put in your measurements, you put in your stuff, right? And it gives you a unique macronutrient ratio for you, but it's always similar to this, you know? For some people, for example, protein can be like 18%, right? Or carbs could be like 7%, right? But it's still gonna stay somewhere in these ratios, okay? So then there's some examples of other macronutrient breakdowns. So in a typical Western diet, so carbs are 60% of your daily intake, and then fats are 25% and proteins 15%. So pretty much the reverse of what we're trying to achieve with the ketogenic diet. A low-carb diet is a little bit better, where it's 50% carbs, 20%, 20% carbs, 50% fat, and 30% protein. And then with the keto, it's this ratio. The other thing to consider is, you know, so like it says, protein is a goal, carbs are a limit, and fat is a lever. So you shouldn't like overdo it on fat just because you can eat all this healthy fat, right? But usually, as far as achieving ketosis, you do need that healthy fat. So sometimes, let's say if you're not in ketosis yet and you need a little bit of help getting into it, you know, you can use that fat as like a lever to try to get yourself into ketosis sooner. Okay. Next.
Is that better?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So who should not do a strict low-carb diet like this? So most people can safely do it, right? So ketogenesis, ketosis on its own is not a harmful process, right? But there are certain people that have to be more careful and do a modified version of it. So it's people who are on diabetes medication, right? So insulin has to be, make sure, you know, you're taking the proper insulin and, you know, just watching your blood glucose. Then if you're taking medication for high blood pressure, and then if you're breastfeeding. So it doesn't mean you can't do the ketogenic program, you just have to adjust it. And we talk about all these modifications in our program guidebook and how to still do this program successfully, even if you're in one of those three categories. So as far as comparing diets, so we have, this is a comparison of low carb versus keto, and then that's a comparison of paleo versus keto. So let's do paleo versus keto first. So the big kind of similarity between paleo and keto is you can't have grains, you can't have beans, and you can't have high quality meats. You can have non-starchy veggies, and you can have, what does it say at the bottom? Oh, like coconut oil, things like that.
Healthy,
yeah,
healthy fats.
Exactly. So now the big difference is in keto, you can have dairy, and we'll actually address that because dairy is not great for everyone. Not everyone should have it, and that's like the unhealthy myth of keto is like you can just have all the dairy you want. You know, it's not really great for everyone. So we'll talk about that. And then with paleo, obviously you can have fruits, which are pretty much a big no-no in all keto except a couple of berries. We'll talk about that. Then starchy veggies, definitely a no-no in ketogenic diet, and also natural sweeteners. So like things like honey and maple syrup, you can have on paleo, not on keto. There are certain sweeteners you can have on keto, and we'll talk about that later on. And so then the difference between low-carb diets, right? So there's Atkins, South Beach, all kinds of low-carb diets, but those don't address the fat that ketogenic diet addresses. So basically, this image kind of just explains that. It's kind of hard to read, but basically talks about you know, ketogenic diet needing to be fat-fueled, and then that way you achieve nutritional ketosis, and eventually you get fat-adapted, which is the goal, right? But your ketosis needs to be adapted to the fat. And that's pretty much it, so comparison of low-carb to keto. Next. Okay, so now this is a big misconception. There's the word ketosis and then the word ketoacidosis. So they, like it says, they're not the same. So in ketosis, you're trying to achieve a low level of ketones in the blood. It's a normal process of the body, like Dr. Morgan mentioned earlier, and it's completely safe, right? Versus in ketoacidosis, it's something that happens to a diabetic. So they dump extremely high levels of ketones into the blood, and they can turn the blood acidic, which is a huge problem. And so, like it says, it occurs in diabetics who don't take enough insulin or aren't well, or people who are starving or alcoholics. So there's no danger of ketoacidosis when you're doing the ketogenic diet because, again, we're looking for low levels of ketones. When you look at the ketone strips, which we'll talk about later, there's like a whole kind of spectrum of ketosis, right? So you don't need to be at the top, like dark red, maroon color. You know, as long as you have even the smallest amount of ketones in your blood, that's good enough. You're in ketosis at that point.
Can I also make another point too? Mm-hmm. That ketoacidosis, you have extremely high ketones and also high blood sugar.
Mm-hmm.
It's that combination where in ketosis, you're not gonna have those extremely
right.
high blood sugar with high ketones.
Exactly.
So it's totally different.
So here are some visual guides as what this would all look like, right? So so if to the left or to my, to the right, yeah, sorry.
Left.
To your left. Yeah, sorry, okay, yeah. Is the like fewer carb, right, foods, and then that way is the higher carb foods. So as you can see, natural fats such as butter, olive oil, etc., are all good, you know, low carb. Meats, fish and seafood, eggs, you know, these are all pretty low carb. Cheese, you know, and then, so vegetables, you know, they vary again from below ground to above ground. The above ground veggies are usually the ones you can have, and the below ground ones are usually the ones you're gonna wanna avoid. So we're gonna get into more of the details about that. So what you should not eat. Things like bananas, which you can see are pretty high in carbs, potatoes, beer, pasta, white rice, bread, donuts, candies, chocolate, soda, juice. All the things we typically think of as being high in sugar,
and
high in carbs.
Every day, all of
unhealthy,
that.
You know, if you will. Yeah.
Well, beer's the best choice on that film.
All right, so what...
You can drink wine, though.
Yeah.
So what can you snack on the ketogenic diet? So, again, the point is not to starve yourself. That's not how you get yourself into ketosis in this case, right? So you can eat eggs, cold cuts, cheeses, avocados, olives. Olives are some of my favorite snacks on the ketogenic diet. I do the ketogenic myself, and that's like my favorite snack. Because you can't eat too many of them because they're salty, but it's just enough to like satiate you, right? And then nuts. And we'll talk about which nuts, but macadamias, pecans, and Brazil nuts are the lowest carb nuts.
What about cottage cheese?
Cottage cheese, it's well, if you're avoiding dairy, which... Most people are more successful actually avoiding dairy on the ketogenic diet. So, you know, if you were to go the no dairy route, then that's a no. Yeah. So, what you can drink. So, obviously, water, coffee, tea are great, and some wines. Like the wine you guys are drinking today, great.
That's like two for what, half a glass or two for a glass?
A glass, yeah.
Like,
Blue vodka and soda water.
Like,
yeah.
Who's glass?
Who's glass? Is that like 8 ounces, 6 ounces, 4 ounces?
I think it's six, based on 6 ounces.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That helps.
Okay. So then what else you can drink, right? So all these kind of non-sugary drinks, right, like whiskeys and brandies and tequila and vodka and soda, a dry martini, those are good. Now we get into all the sugary ones like Bloody Marys, margaritas, Cosmopolitans, White Russians,
Rum
and
Coke,
all these things, avoid, avoid, avoid. Yeah. So again, you shouldn't...
38 carbs in a Rum and Coke?
Yeah.
Well, that's Pepsi.
Yeah,
or Coke,
yeah. So
it's real
the idea about giving
about
this information is that not that we're encouraging
Coke.
You to drink alcohol every day,
yeah.
You know,
Captain
but if you have to have a drink, you have options, yeah. Okay, so as far as what healthy fats and sauces look like, okay, so again, butter's on there, and again, dairy's not for everyone, so, you know, it's up, you know, some people already know they're sensitive to dairy, other people start a ketogenic diet, and they're stalling, and then they take out the dairy, and, you know, there's, you know, a movement. So, again, it's different for everyone, but olive oil, coconut oil, mayo, all kinds of things. So heavy cream is on here. So, you know, it is one of those myths that, like, you know, you just eat heavy cream all day long, you know, and that's okay. You can have it once in a while, but, again, I wouldn't focus on those types of fats. And then it talks about obviously things you should avoid, like ketchup and maple syrup, barbecue sauces, jams, things like that. Those things are definitely big.
How about avocado oil? Because I see it has the
avocado
olive oil.
Yeah, that's, you can definitely have avocado oil. Because you can have avocados, yeah. Okay, so fruits. So pretty much all fruits are a no-no. Everything at the bottom, you're going to want to avoid. Even lemons are sick. So, you know, if you have a squeeze of a lemon, that's fine, right? But you shouldn't eat, like, a whole lemon because that's actually a pretty carby fruit. Now, as far as berries go, blueberries are actually really high in carbs. I know most people think blueberries are okay, but they're actually, out of all the berries, they're the ones you should avoid. Mm-hmm. Raspberries, strawberries, and blackberries are your best option. And, again, those are things that, if you really feel like having a berry, you know, a couple of berries, those are the berries you should have. But in general, try to avoid fruits if you can.
That's easy.
Okay, so now veggies. Pretty much all the above ground veggies are great, as you can see.
Those are nightshades.
So many options. So again, so some nightshades, let's say you have an autoimmune problem, we know those are things you should avoid, right? Mm-hmm. So, but there's other options, right, besides in the nightshade family. Lettuces and, you know, cucumbers and cauliflower, like the cauliflower salad we have today, right? And then you can see there's plenty of options as far as veggies go.
And none of those are too bad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, if you look at the below ground veggies, this, you know, the really starchy ones, carrots,
and onions.
So again, onions. You can, let's say you want to saute some meat, right? And you want to stay with some onion. That's fine. Just don't, you know, use a whole onion for like one serving type of thing, right? So beets and potatoes and sweet potatoes. Yeah, actually look at sweet potato, it's 17. Mm. Yeah. You know, most people think of a sweet potato as a healthier version of the potato, right? But as far as carbs go, that's not the case. And then as far as nuts, like I already mentioned, pecans, macadamias, and Brazil nuts are your best options. What I love about Brazil nuts, they're so hard and kind of big. You can't eat too many of them, so you're not gonna sit there and kind of snack and snack and snack on them, right? But these are what, you know, when we talked about fat being a lover, like if you need to add a little bit of extra fat to your day too, nuts are a good choice because they're high in the healthy fats. They also have that protein, right? And then they're low in carbs. So those are great options. Almonds, which most people think are good nuts to snack on, actually are pretty on the higher end. Again, you can use, there's some recipes that call for almond flour, and that's fine, you know? Again, you're not gonna be using too much of it. But in general, as far as just kind of sitting there and snacking on nuts, almonds, cashews, pistachios, you should avoid those because you can easily overdo it with those. Okay, so then what about sweeteners, right? So there's two types of sweeteners that you can have on the keto diet. So one is called stevia, which I'm sure we've all heard of. Another one is called monk fruit. And it's actually in a lot of, if you read the labels, it's used as a sweetener in a lot of like the healthier, you know, foods. And it actually tastes pretty good. So either one of those can be used as a sweetener for your coffee, for your recipes, you know. So they're really, really good options. And they don't have an impact on your blood sugar and your insulin like, you know, regular sugar, fake sweeteners do, like Splenda and things like that. Then we talked about dairy-free keto, right? So if you know you're sensitive to dairy, avoid it, right? Whether you've been tested for it or you just know just from, you know, your daily eating, right? So there are so many options to doing dairy-free keto. I do dairy-free keto myself, and I'm never, like, at a loss of what to eat. So, again, it just kind of shows that you're not going to go hungry if you're doing dairy-free keto. That's kind of the point of this picture. There's also a vegan keto food pyramid type of situation. I wouldn't necessarily advise it, but if you're already vegan to, I wouldn't advise it if you're like not vegan and you know you're starting keto, do the regular keto. If you're already vegan and still want to do keto, there are those modifications and the guidebook in our program actually talks about that more in detail. But this is kind of just an idea of, you know, that you can still eat certain things even though you're on the vegan diet. Okay, so this is what a typical shopping list would look like. So you'll get all that
information. Ribeye steak, yeah. Oh, yummy.
You'll get all that information in the guidebook, okay? So we can, yeah, this was just kind of just to show you that there's lots of options, yeah. All right, so the big thing I want you to all come away with is reading labels, right? So obviously, like, you know, fruits, veggies, blah, 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 meats, you not necessarily need to read labels on those things, right? But as far as, like, anything that's, like a processed food, if you will, definitely read the labels, okay? As far as, you know, counting your carbs, proteins, fats, there's a lot of apps. There's an app that I recommend in the booklet that it's called Carb Manager that they already have like input of like thousands of foods, so you can just like even scan it and it'll give you exact net carbs and all of that. But regardless, you should always read the label and see what's in there. And if you go to the next slide, it actually shows you how to calculate carbs if you have to. Like, if you're like, you know, in the middle of summer and you want to snack quickly and you want to see how many net. So we're calculating net carbs. There's total carbs and there's net carbs. So what net carbs are, so if you look at a label, right, so we have total carbs, which is 8 grams, right? Then there's fiber right under that. Then there's sugar and then there's sugar alcohol. So the way you calculate net carbs is you do total carbs, so which would be 8 grams in this case, minus the fiber, which would be 6 grams, minus the sugar alcohols, because sugar alcohols are not processed like regular sugar in your body, and they're not counted towards your total net carb. So it would be 8 minus 6 minus 1, so for a total net carb of 1, actually. So whatever this is really low in net carbs. So there's a lot of information out there about counting carbs versus total carbs versus net carbs. I have found, and a lot of people have found, that counting net carbs is more effective than counting total carbs. So that's the way we are going to be doing this program, is counting net carbs. And then just another thing, this is 20 grams of carbs, net carbs, I should say, in two ways, right? So this is what 20 grams of net carbs looks like in veggies versus half of a bagel, right? And then a little more of a breakdown of, they include berries in here, just, but in general, you can see 20 grams of net carbs versus 20 grams of net carbs, right? So that's a little interesting comparison for you guys. So then any questions about ketosis in general? Mm-hmm. No? Okay, so then Dr. Morgan will talk about our program itself.
Okay. I do have one question, yeah. Like how do you know to test your ketones, like if you're in ketosis?
So we'll talk, yeah, there's a slide that shows about testing. So you're saying when to test? How do you know when to test?
Yeah, like when, how long does it usually take if you start doing it? Perfect,
yeah.
To get into ketosis.
Mm-hmm. It takes a couple weeks usually, but you know, you can start just kind of testing to even get a baseline, right, to see where you're at, you know, a week into it if you wanted to, just for yourself.
Should
you
I
know?
Test before I even start to see where I'm at?
You're probably not going to be in ketosis before you start. Very little chance of that, yeah.
Not my bologna.
And what about the ketones that are out there that come from a lot of different places?
So we're going to talk about
okay.
Exogenous ketones, yeah. Mm-hmm. So basically, you shouldn't rely on them to get into ketosis, but they are like a support, you know, once you're in the ketogenic diet, or if you're really having trouble getting into ketosis, they can be a supportive element in that. But the main goal is the diet, right? And then the supplements play a supporting role.
Okay. So it's not something you have to take along with it, or you don't have to.
It is part of our program.
It is? Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Recommended.
So we put together an 8-week ketogenic weight loss program. And so what it is, so you get a patient guidebook, and we give you it, an electronic version of this, an ebook basically, and this has everything you need for the 8-week program. And so what that program includes is an evaluation, so a doctor evaluation. So it's a 30-minute visit. We do a whole health intake and just make sure, you know, you're familiar with the ketogenic program, and we go through the guidebook with you and just kind of what to expect doing the program. And we just make sure it's a good fit for you and that it would be appropriate for you to start a keto diet. And then we'll go through the whole program guidebook with you and make sure you understand everything that you're going to be doing and how to start the program. And then we do weekly progress checks. So that's for 8 weeks. Every week we'll check in with you. So you either come into the office or we can do it over the phone if you can't make it into the office. And it's a 15-minute visit. And that's great to kind of just make sure that you're progressing really well on the program and just to answer any questions you have. And then we're also, if you have email support as well, you know, so, which is great. So anytime you have questions, you can always email. And so that support's available also. And then the program also includes the ketogenic diet supportive supplements, as Dr. Galena mentioned. There's four supplements that we have included in the program that just kind of help support the whole process, helping you just get into ketosis and then stay in ketosis. Next slide. So the program's divided into three phases. So the first phase is kind of just introducing you to ketosis, to the program, and then understanding how to do a proper keto diet, going over the dietary guidelines, discussing the supportive supplements, the dosing, and then the weekly follow-ups. And so each phase, it's going to be kind of individual in terms of how long you're in each phase, because the first phase is just making sure that you understand the whole program and getting into ketosis. That's like the most challenging part, wouldn't you say, Carolina?
Yeah.
I mean, is kind of switching your body from carb burning to fat burning. And that can be the most challenging part for people because you're kind of changing your body's metabolism. And so we support you through that. So that's phase one. And then phase two is like once you're in ketosis, then we help you maintain that. And so that's just maintaining, like, you know, when you find like the correct amount of carbs you should be eating and fat. So when you figure out your specific ratio, then this is just about maintaining that. And so if you get stuck, as Dr. Lena mentioned, then we kind of help you through those plateaus if that happens. And then phase three is just, you know, continuing the whole healthy eating plan and helping you reach your weight loss goal. So, and then again, just continuing to support supplements, checking in with the doctor to make sure that you're reaching your goals.
And I want to mention that it's really easy to slip out of ketosis. You know, that's the truth. So that's why, you know, you're constantly testing yourself. But also the reason for those supportive supplements is, you know, they kind of help you get a handle on that. If you slip out of ketosis, like, don't beat yourself up. You know, that's what those supplements are there for, to help get you back into it without going crazy, right? But also that's what we're there for, you know. So if you're like, oh my god, I slipped out of ketosis, I don't know what to do, shoot us an email and, you know, we'll help you get back on track.
Yeah, and I think that's like the most overwhelming part for doing, like, starting a ketogenic diet. It's like you were asking a question, like, how do you test your ketones, and like that can be really confusing, and knowing how to, like, you know, what level you should be reaching. And so we go through all of that with you in the program. And like Dr. Galena said, it's easy to kind of to get stuck. And so we're here to answer any questions you have and support you through the entire process.
And there's also, I was going to say quickly, there's a lot of, like, misinformation out there and a lot of keto Facebook groups and websites and whatnot, you know, and there's so many differing opinions on how you should do things, what you should eat, what you shouldn't eat, what, you know, what macros you should follow. There's so many different opinions on that, right? So it's kind of hard to know what to believe. So, like, and let's say you're in the ketogenic program, right, with us, and then all of a sudden you go online and read something crazy, please, before, like, jumping the gun on that, contact me, contact Dr. Morgan, and say, hey, like, what do you think about this, you know? Yeah, that's what we're there for.
Yeah. And then, and once you are, like, in a, like, they call it fat adapted.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot easier, like if you do slip
mm-hmm.
out of ketosis, to get back in.
Exactly.
It's not going to be like that whole process in the beginning where your body's trying to, you know,
learn.
Yeah. Okay, and then are you going to talk about
I
this
can,
or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let me go back.
Yeah.
So different ways to test your ketone levels, and the most common, popular, and cheap way is the urine testing, right? So it's these strips. It comes like a set of 100 of them, I think, if not more. So many out there. The ones that I use are called SmackFat, funny enough, the funny name, but they're pretty accurate, and they're one of the most accurate in the market from all the research I've done. And basically, you just, you know, pee in a cup, stick your stick in there, wait a few seconds, and then on the actual container, you have like a little comparison chart, and you compare where you're at. And again, you don't have to be all the way like the dark maroon ketones. You don't necessarily even want to be there, right? As long as you're in any level of, not like, you don't want to be also like super, super low on the ketones, but you want to be somewhere like low to middle, right, on the strips.
So that doesn't necessarily, the color of your urine doesn't necessarily matter.
Mm-hmm. No, it's not the color.
I still don't want to check
yeah.
the actual
the
ketones.
Color of your urine is more like if you're dehydrated,
vitamins.
It'll be darker, or if you're taking certain vitamins, it'll be, you know, a certain
I take
color.
Water pills too. I'm supposed
yeah.
to take water pills, and I take
yeah.
them every day.
So, exactly.
Sometimes it's really clear, sometimes not.
Yeah.
So
you
yeah,
just, yeah, you just
yeah.
dip the strip into the urine, and then you, and again, it says very affordable, but not always reliable. I've actually found it to be really reliable. It shouldn't scare you off, you know, and it is the most affordable option. They're saying not always reliable in the sense when you compare it to like other things, maybe that's gonna give you more like exact ketone numbers, right? But I haven't had any issues with the strips. Then there's also the blood testing, which is basically a glucose meter, right? And then you put strips to actually monitor ketosis, right? So that is accurate, but it is expensive. And then the last test is a breath test where you take these, it's like a, you know, a little meter that you blow into it, and then it basically measures your ketones. And again, it says it's actually most affordable option, but not most reliable. So if I were to, you know, say use one of these, I would say doing the ketone strips. Okay, so then we have some supportive supplements. You want to grab
those? Oh,
yes. Yeah. So these are what are called exogenous ketones, right? So it's the same idea, right? So you're producing ketones in your body, right? But sometimes when you need a little help getting into ketosis, you add these exogenous ketones, which are also natural ketones, and they're made of calcium and sodium and something called beta hydroxybutyrate, and they help induce ketosis, and also once you're in ketosis, help maintain ketosis. For this supplement, we are only giving 1 month supply. It's really when you're starting out that this most effective, right, to help you induce ketosis. Ketogenic? Oh, wait. The salt. Oh, the enzymes, right. The enzyme. Okay, so ketozymes. Just basically help boost absorption and digestion of fats, right, because now we're relying heavily on fats in our diet, so these ketozymes help.
What's the difference between those enzymes and regular enzymes?
It has a higher amount of lipase,
yeah, exactly.
Which is the enzyme for breaking down fat.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, obviously, because you're eating much more.
And
fat.
Then it has dandelion root and artichoke, which help with the process
mm-hmm.
of digestion. Yeah. Okay.
And gallbladder.
Next, we have this huge bottle. And so everything else is a 2 month supply except the ketone salts. So then the MCT oil. So basically, this is something you could put in your bulletproof coffee, or you could put in your salads, or whichever way, right? So basically, as it says here, it goes directly to your liver, and it's converted into ketones for quick energy. Helps you reach and maintain ketosis, speeds up the burning of fat stores, and optimizes your cognitive function. So it has many...
We put it in what?
You can put it in your bulletproof coffee,
yeah.
Or you can put it in your salad, or take it as a spoon if you really want to.
It's flavorless,
yeah.
So you could add it to anything.
Yeah, and then last but not least, L-carnitine, which just helps support fat metabolism.
Mm-hmm.
And we're actually raffling off these two together, right, or no?
These two together, the MCT with the L-carnitine, and then we're going to raffle off these two. So two people are going to walk around.
But you get all these, if you sign up for the program, you also get all these supplements.
Yeah,
I think we should just have a drawing, and each person gets
one.
Oh, yeah.
That's more fair.
So someone walks away
good
with
idea.
Something.
Then you all get something.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great idea.
I'm a winner. I wanted to win them all.
Do you want to
come on,
B.
You're going to get them all.
This is the part of being full.
Yeah.
So
everything
else that
goes on is that I've done all the other things here. Everything else has always been really low fat.
You're not allowed.
Like everything. So,
it's true.
And then
oh,
I did high protein,
and
then I did the high protein
yeah.
to try to maintain. So I'm just wondering, are some people more successful with this versus the other two, or is this, I mean, what differentiates? I mean, I feel like I've always been successful
yeah.
with the other ones, but I can always like
yeah.
get back on.
Well, like for instance,
if I'm not
like
on
our
it,
HCG
so.
Weight loss program, which is low calorie, like zero fat,
no zero.
Fat. It's just it's different, and that's
yeah.
for. Short-term, quick weight loss, it's not sustainable. Obviously, you don't stay on that
mm-hmm.
long-term, but
it's
to help
hard.
People who are stuck
yes.
because it does help
it does.
With resistant weight loss and, like, people
just
who tried everything, and
like
it just kind of helps reset the...
Mm-hmm.
It helps reset
yeah.
the metabolism.
Right. So you could do that, and then, you know, with ketogenic, it's like a lifestyle. So
yeah.
you could continue it long-term. But it's just a different mechanism of action, whereas
mm-hmm.
the HCG is working on... like rebalancing, resetting the area in the brain. This is more working on just switching your metabolism to fat burning versus
okay.
carb burning. But
yeah.
so they're just different in that.
Because also if you're also just doing low carb without the fat, right, you're not really switching to that fat burning mechanisms that we talked about. So that's,
right.
Yeah.
So this sounds like it might be more successful.
Yeah.
Don't
well,
hang
you
up.
Are switching, but only while you're taking the pill, the HCG.
No, I'm not talking about. I'm just saying in general. If you're just doing just the low carb diet,
yeah.
just low carb with like healthy proteins, right? And but you're still doing low fat. You're not
yeah.
inducing that ketosis. Yeah. Okay. So just as far as exercise, right? For sure, you know, exercise is great, and you know, for a lot of things, right? For obviously, just weight loss is great for. It's great for mood. It's just
heart.
Good for overall well-being
mm-hmm.
for your heart. Exactly. But then the studies have shown. The keto with no exercise beats standard diet and exercise. So we're not discouraging exercise, but again, it just goes to show how effective ketogenic diet is, that even if you didn't do any exercise, you still have success with it. And that's just quoting a study that says they found that those following the low carb plan advocated by the diet saw the most health benefits compared to those on a typical diet, whether the latter carried out physical activity or not. That's from an actual scientific study that was done not too long ago. And then just four types of exercise that you can do. So you can do cardio, you can do weightlifting, you can do yoga, stretching, you can do like balance and core training. So you can do everything you've always been doing, right? You know, whatever works for you. So you don't have to necessarily start exercise when you start the keto diet, but you also don't have to stop exercise when you start the keto diet. So, you know, just we work with what, you know, if you feel great doing exercise, great. You know, if you don't feel like you can start exercise right away when you're doing the keto diet, you know, don't force yourself. So work up to it eventually. You know, once you start losing the weight and feeling better and getting healthier, you'll
want
to add the exercise
to.
Part to this. Yeah. And again, just reinstating what the weight loss benefits are. Obviously, you're burning more fat, you're reducing your hunger, and you're stabilizing blood sugar. So three great benefits. Out of the many that happen when you're in ketosis. So any questions?
So you're burning more fat than muscle when you're doing the ketosis.
You're not losing any muscle, yeah.
Yeah, you're just burning.
Don't a lot of like long distance athletes do the do this diet in order to burn fat for fuel rather than?
Yeah. Well, I feel like a lot of athletes do the, they rotate, you know,
yeah.
so they do the, they do the loading, so they load up on the carbs, and then they do the unloading, right? Or I don't know what they call it, cutting, I think they call it, where they
the
cut
cycling.
The carbs. Yeah, the
but,
cycling, yeah.
But you can still be, like, an athlete and still be
right.
really active
yeah.
and do the keto diet.
Yeah.
That's kind of, like, the point we were making with the whole
mm-hmm.
exercise thing.
Yeah.
It's just, like, so somebody who's super athletic and working out a lot, weightlifting, their ratio of carbs, they'll have
mm-hmm.
to eat a little
exactly.
bit more carbs than somebody who is less active.
Yeah.
So that's the only thing that would change would be like the ratio of protein, fat, and carbs.
And then how do you figure that out? That
so there's, well, when you come in for your first appointment, we'll pull up a calculator and figure all that out, yeah.
But also just how you feel, like when you're going through the program, because sometimes you can have
right.
like
yeah.
certain symptoms that would indicate, okay, you need to add a little bit more carbs.
Yeah,
so that's my hard part.
So,
like knowing what my ratio is gonna be, like the percentages. Is
right.
Part of
so we'll
figure
all that out.
We can figure that out for you.
And then, yeah, the guidebook also talks about, and there are like possible symptoms, if you will. There's something called the keto flu, for example. But we talk about how to combat that, and it's all really only in the beginning too. So, you know, maybe when you're having that keto flu, you might not want to like exercise either, right? But once you get over that hump, you should feel.
So if you start your day off with like too much carbs, do you then have to eat enough fat and protein to offset that?
Yeah. Well,
that's one way.
You
to
shouldn't go over 20 grams, about 20 grams of net carbs, regardless.
Yeah.
But you don't want to have your 20 grams right in the morning, and because that throws off your blood sugar for the rest of the day, right?
Yeah.
And then you're also going to be stuck with meal options. You know what you can.
What does 20 carbs look like? 20 grams of carbs, like, is that like two?
So like the sample, no, like the sample, the picture that we showed earlier with the meals.
She
yeah,
people?
Out of the room.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, so we can show you that slide. They're basically, you're not starving. Again, this is not the point. Is not calories.
There.
Oh,
wait,
yeah.
Past,
yeah.
There.
Oh well.
20
yeah.
grams.
So that's 20 for a whole day over there.
Well. Yeah, but you're not gonna eat like a whole plate of berries.
No,
right?
But I mean like that's.
Go, no, I meant
to like,
the
whole
the sample
day.
Menu.
Yeah.
Go back to the sample
okay.
menu all the way in the beginning, like one of the.
Going. Yeah, it's in the very beginning.
I'm sorry.
Oh no,
please.
No,
it's.
Yeah.
Oh,
no, no, no.
Go back. Yeah, right there.
Okay.
This is like a typical day. A typical day. A typical day.
And
know?
It's just an example.
Yeah.
But
what is
I'm
that?
Not,
those round things in that lunch. First
like
lunch.
It's like falafel balls.
Oh, I think it's like. Maybe meatballs or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
no,
these balls, but there's like
no
bread or anything like that. Yes,
yeah.
You, it's
no
and grains. No
carbs.
No grains.
So
yeah.
Any carbs you're eating is basically from vegetables.
Yeah,
yeah
pretty much.
Pretty
I mean.
Much.
But you can see some nuts have carbs. And
yeah.
Yeah.
And berries, you know. And it is true that it's easy for the carbs to add up, like,
yeah.
You know, but
yeah.
That's why you use these trackers, which are really
I
easy.
I just get to eat more protein
yeah.
and fat.
Yeah.
The trackers on the apps I have, the carb tracker app, it's pretty awesome. Like,
yeah.
You can buy a package of something, and it shows your
exactly.
phone, and it'll scan it and tell you, and you're like,
yeah.
All right, cool, so.
Carb Manager is the best one out of all
so
that.
So why is lunch
mm-hmm.
so late on here?
Oh, that's just, this was actually a doctor who does the ketogenic diet, and like that's his lifestyle.
Right.
This is actually his meal.
Right.
That
so that
he,
bulletproof coffee is supposed to make you full. Till
he goes 6 hours without.
Really?
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
I can do that.
Yeah.
I cannot.
Because when
I
you're
can't.
That's
no
the
way.
Thing with
did,
the ketogenic, when
no.
you're eating like
right.
a higher fat
really
diet,
yeah.
you can go longer without
that's
eating.
Yeah. Work as well.
You feel really
it's
full and satiated.
Yeah.
Do you only get one cup of the bulletproof coffee?
No, you
like
can have as much coffee as you want. There's no limit
coffee.
As far as
coffee
goes.
But like that bulletproof
style.
I think it works
better.
But bulletproof,
right,
you're putting
the,
that stuff in it, right?
Yeah, so
yeah,
the fat
there's no carbs
is
in that.
Same
so.
But again, you have
hungry,
a huge amount of fat that you can actually eat per day, healthy fat, right?
And then what about, say, I was hungry and I wanted to have, or like I want a snack,
yeah,
I use bulletproof coffee as a snack.
Yeah, a lot of people do
actually.
You can.
You don't have to. I mean, you saw there that one slide that had all those ideas for snacks.
Yeah.